Can you tell us about the City Extension Project?
So this movement, I mean, this is to just say the most important thing in a city is to maintain a supply of land so that the price of land will not escalate. You know, you will have an elasticity, you'll have a response. You know, if the price of land increases, then the supply will also increase to compensate that. It has also another advantage, is that because they tend to provide a grid, say a kilometer, a little less, or a little more, it will ensure that a system of transport will be more efficient in the future as the city grow.
And the vision is very much like New York City in 1811, which looked northward and gridded its land, even though there was nobody living on it at that point in time. Empty land on the edge of the city and grid it right now. So we're going to...
That's right, yeah. Where, you see, a city like Mexico City, which was not supposed to expand, and there was even a law to protect the farmers in the, you know, around Mexico City, the ejidos, which prevented them from selling land to developers. You know, the state had the monopoly. You know, they had to first release their land to the state, and the state will contact. You know, it was to protect them against greedy developer. But the result was that the farmers very soon realized that selling a little piece of land will give them an income which was about 5 or 10 years maybe what they could get from the land itself, and therefore sold to developers or informal developers. But because the state will not acknowledge it, there will be no roads, no major roads. So, you know, let's say the city is successful economically, land is going to be developed, but developed without trunk infrastructure. And then after that, it's very difficult. You know, that's a problem, especially in the north of Mexico City.
Retrofitting
is expensive. Sadly enough, the more democratic is a country, the more difficult it is, because you have to expropriate, and you have to use eminent domain. And of course, it's subject to court, rightly so.
Yep.
This is nearly impossible to do after.
In the grid plan, if you put together a grid area, what's to stop squatters from just going into the space that's been allocated for streets? That's often felt to me one of the hardest parts of these plans. It takes us back to, you can draw a red line saying there's no developing on the streets, but how do you enforce it?
You know, if you, the land belongs to somebody. You know, in a way, what this grid does, it separates public land for private land, you know, which, so in a way it's established property right in advance. You have squatters only in cities where the land use regulations are such that a formal developer cannot develop land for the majority of migrants. You know, it makes too expensive. So if you had this grid, which is established, my guess, and if you have no minimum standards, you know, that you can basically subdivide land the way you want, you will not have squatters. People don't forget that squatters are not, they are squatters on a very short time. That means people who do not pay for land. Mm-hmm. They always pay for land. There's always a market. You know, within 1 year if you have an invasion, if you have, within 1 year, there will be a complete market. Land will be traded. Sometimes gangsters or some politician will ask you for protection money.
Sure.
But there will be a market. I have never seen a so-called squatter settlement where there were no market.